Welcome to On the Edge with April Mahoney Brains. Here, this is the spot where the conversations are pointed, the guests are sharp, and the responses are never dull. Did you bring your thinking caps? Because it's time to put them on. Because the conversation starts now. Makes me feel like I'm right there in damn Colorado.
Come on over, girl. Come before it snows.
I know, that's a trip too, coming from California, going into the snow. Gotta shovel snow and wear boots and drive on ice. Girl, you're doing way too much, if you ask me.
I agree, I'm coming back.
Come on back. But it's a beautiful place. What got you there to Colorado? What sent you there?
Well, so I was here in the early 70s. My parents were very adventurous and they came out to Boulder, Colorado. And at the time, I mean, there were maybe 40,000 people there. And I followed them out and stayed until around 1989 and said, I need California. So
right.
I moved to LA, started a family, a business, all of those kinds of things. And now I'm back here because I help care for my 91-year-old mom and her business.
Wow. What kind of business does your mom have?
She is in the antique jewelry business, and she specializes in Georgian and Victorian antiques.
Wow. Well, you know, congratulations. I just lost my mother. It'll be coming up on a year, and she was 91. And you know what? Being a caregiver is no joke. So, you know, I send you love.
Thank you. I will take it.
But you know what? People don't understand that it is a blessing to be able, number one, to have a relationship with anybody that you want to care for.
Yeah.
Because that has to be a want.
Yeah.
You know, some people, I know people right now, they say, you know what? I can't do it.
Yep.
So, and then to have the relationship with the person or to be able to merge a relationship together that they want you to take care of them.
Yep.
Some people don't want that either.
Yep.
But you've been able to take care of yourself, to take care of your mother, to take care of your personal effects, but also help others in the area of the big D, the divorce. Brains, we're talking about that again. The consciously uncoupling, breaking up with folks. But how to do it and be civil, to how to do it and still have a sense of gravitas and elegance and grace about yourself. It's not about the other person, brains. It's all about you and how you're going to process this and where are you going to go after this. I just had an amazing woman on the show that talked about divorce, negotiation, and arbitration and mediation. On the edge. So we're really kind of getting down and dirty because just like you were happy when you got with somebody, you can be happy when you get rid of them. Right, Sue?
And even be happier.
Ooh. So tell my brains, please, here on the edge, how you show up in the world and what are you doing there in Colorado?
Okay. Well, as I mentioned, I'm doing some caretaking, but I really came here to build my coaching practice in life transitions and divorce. And I help people divorce differently. And by that, I mean to take the contentiousness and the victimization and all of those negative aspects of ending a relationship and do it with, as you mentioned, a little more grace, ease, and less expense and less ruination for all the parties involved. So that's what I do. A lot of my work is, and then after the divorce, I work with my clients on rebuilding their lives and moving forward so that they can reinvent themselves and be happy and become joyous heads of their own households.
Because after a divorce, I'm sure that, you know, individuals feel like they've been stripped down to their knickers.
Yeah. And then some.
And then you've got to, again, start all over again. And let's talk to the woman that is the fortunate one that has been taken care of all of this time, but doesn't have a sense of self-worth, never had to work a job, never had to pay the bills. All she did was take care of the kids and take them to soccer practice, or had a nanny. And now here you are. You have to peel back all of those layers like an onion and say, wow, this is who I am, and this is really what I want to do. How do you work with that person? Because they're still very vulnerable. They're still very tender. Oh. And sometimes very bitter.
I mean, the most important step for anyone in rebuilding in a divorce, and it starts with accepting the fact that this has happened. And when you're bitter, you have not accepted that. And you can't accept it. And so we spend a lot of time working on just being able to live with what is. In other words, stop the self-talk about revenge, or, you know, if they're looking on social media to see what's going on next, and all of those kinds of things. Those are very unproductive types of things. And what is important is that someone who's gone through divorce reframes their relationship with the spouse. In other words, you've got to, number one, accept that the person you married is not the person you divorced. Mm-hmm. And whatever the relationship was, that's not what it's ever going to be again. And in not only your mind, and if you're fortunate enough to have an ongoing relationship because of children or whatever, really work through what the new boundaries and rules are in the relationship. So those are some of the first steps that I find myself working with my clients on. It's like, okay, there's that. And, you know, for a woman, as you described, which is pretty common in a gray divorce where they've stayed at home and taken care of children, et cetera, every aspect of their lives externally as well as internally, how they describe themselves is being rearranged. So, you know, as I said, being a single head of household, they've never thought of themselves as that. So it's really starting to redefine each aspect of your life, and adding purpose and meaning for yourself into those areas that exclude your former spouse.
And, you know, that's a certain maturity level. I tell people all the time, you got to put on your big girl panties or your big boy drawers, because people get divorced for a variety of reasons. You know, I had a family member that was forced to marry one of my family members, and he said he was going out to get some cigarettes. Girl, that joke ain't never come back. And it happens.
It does. It does.
Allowing a person to love unconditionally. Do I believe in that? No. Honestly, I don't love unconditionally. There's conditions on mine. Because you come at me, you know, way crazy, then the conditions on the love have changed.
Right.
But getting into that courtroom, hearing all of the dirty, you know, laundry, seeing all the money that's been hidden, or really dealing with the hurt, because sometimes people are really in love and then another person just says, I'm not there anymore.
Right.
It takes a lot, you know, it takes a lot of counseling, but I'm hoping that people take the time, don't rush into the divorce, you know, take the time to, again, do some self-actualization, like you said, figure out where you are, kind of have a snapshot of where you want to be. And all of the other key elements. How are you going to tell the children? You know, where is going to be your new home?
Right.
You know, how are you going to generate some income? Because alimony and child support only last for so long. And then trying to destroy the other individual.
Right.
If you destroy the other individual, like you said, revenge, when you plant plot revenge, baby, you better dig two graves.
Yeah, exactly.
Because
it's very true.
It's going to come back to haunt you. It's going to come back to haunt you. Now, I know you say, oh, well, you know, you can talk all that smack because you're married and this, that, and the other. But I always saved a little bit for me, Sue. I always reserved a little bit of me because my life is not contingent on my spouse. They change their mind. They get sick. They die. They lose interest. It gets boring. All of those things. So if I lose track and lose sight of who I am, then how am I going to have an expectation of you to make me feel a certain kind of way? Wouldn't you agree?
I completely agree. And what's so interesting in that divorcing process and that, you know, rearranging yourself internally is that there's so much uncertainty. And so when you say rightfully, you know, have a vision for yourself, I think for those of us who've lived independent and been within ourselves, in a strong person with a fairly solid self-identity, it's a little bit easier for us. But so often for some clients, they have no vision. And in that kind of situation, you start with, how do you want to feel? You know, and then how you
or who you want to fill up on
or that, you know, I don't recommend that right away, but there's a time and a place.
It's a stress reliever. It can be a great distraction now, Sue. You
there
know,
you
can get your mind off of it.
That's true. So, but yeah, it's a pretty interesting process to work with people. And, you know, you mentioned the things about courts and drama. And really, I mean, we see that in the movies and in the high profile divorce cases, especially having been in the LA area, you know, you can read about it in the paper. But for the other 90% of people getting divorced, nobody cares. Judges don't care. No one cares about the drama. And what I find, and I work with attorneys on this, is if you don't want to end up in court and you don't want to end up in litigation and spending thousands and thousands of dollars, which, you know, just go ahead and burn money, those issues that existed in the marriage don't matter. So infidelity, the courts don't really care about that. What people care about is the financial part and the family and the children part. So
they changed that. I don't know. I remember back in the day, they used to be able to get a divorce for sexual indiscretion.
Yeah.
Now they just say irreconcilable.
Irreconcilable
differences. Now, whatever that is, that's a big $25 word that I couldn't say, but it's got a lot into it. So again, like you said, they're not looking at who was cheating on who, or, you know, they don't care about that. They want to dissolve and liquidate the asset.
Right. And I mean, if you're fortunate enough to have a mutually agreed to or a good enough relationship with your spouse to be able to navigate those things and negotiate who's going to get what, and everybody's honest about the money, and you can see where these things are. And there are people who get divorced that way, that are able to make those changes. That's fabulous. But very often there are things like hiding money, especially if one spouse is working and the other one isn't. There are things like pensions and this and that. And there are so many tax and accounting situations that you need to take into consideration before you divorce, especially if you're 60 and above. I mean, how much of career time are you really going to have, and how much can you earn? So very often in a situation like that, it's best to really focus on the business of divorce and in any kind of divorce, focus on what's important, and that's dividing assets.
But the expense of it as well. Yeah. You know, an attorney is not cheap brains, and they don't do it pro bono.
No, they don't.
You know, every phone call, every email, every court appearance, every summons, every disclosure, all of that is just racking up what you could probably, again, after you get your head around it, you know, give yourself some time. You may wake up and don't just walk into, you know, someone had this conversation with me. They don't just walk into the room and say, I want a divorce right now. Okay, well then give me, you know, 30, 60 days to kind of figure out and ingest.
Yep.
And then look at it and see if we can have some counseling, have some conversation. You know, now there are situations where you need to get out right away. If there's abuse.
Get out.
Maybe mental illness, maybe, you know, drug abuse, those kind of things.
Yeah.
But if you have an opportunity to really reassess and think back on why you married this individual, there is some good in this individual.
Oh.
You had kids with them. And then how are your kids? What kind of conversations do you have with your clients around telling the children and supporting them during this process?
In the best of cases, it's important for both parents to have their plans, and children don't need to know the minute this is happening. I usually recommend that the parents are able to kind of have an idea how things are going to work, and be pretty far along the process so that the kids are, they're going to be afraid, they're going to be sad, they're going to have the same sets of emotions that we all go through when a relationship ends. They're going to grieve, you know, there's so much loss, but it's so important as a parent to have the appropriate mindset of keeping kids safe emotionally in this time. And so, you know, parents need to be on the same page about what's going to happen when kids go from one house to the next. And I think I was listening to someone talk about, you know, some of the parenting rules. And here in the state of Colorado, if you have children, you consult with a parenting coordinator and things like that. And, you know, if you haven't been big on feeding your kids organic food, and now that's something you want to do, you can't expect your spouse to feed them organic food either.
But
and you can't
there's put so that many in. Other, but there's so many other contributing factors outside of just that. And, you know, I want to shine a light on them. You know, children feel a lot of times that it's their fault.
Yeah.
They want their biological parents. They're moving to a different school. They're meeting new friends. Now they're going to have to meet the significant other or partner to their parents and incorporate that in their life. They are going to rebel. They're going to shut down. They may turn to drugs or alcohol, sexual promiscuity. It's a laundry list. So take that into consideration more so, in my opinion, than your adult spouse, because they're going to go on and do their thing.
Right.
And you're going to maybe have 50% custody. The other person's going to have 50% of the co-parenting. But really that little mind, that little person is going to be impacted by this for the rest of their life. And they didn't ask to come here. You two got together and bumped your uglies and had this baby. And now all of a sudden, you know, you want to use that child as a pawn. Oh, you can't go see your father because of blah, blah, blah. Or your father did not pay child support. Well, you know, okay, I get it. But support is not contingent upon custody and having a relationship. Maybe they can't do it. Maybe you really don't know what's going on the other side. Open your brain up. Open your mind up. You know, take the emotion out of it. Because a lot of times it's control. It's the money and the sex. Okay, well, you know, now he's having sex with this person or that person. I've got some friends that have some very interesting relationships as well as divorces. My one girlfriend stays upstairs. Her ex-husband stays downstairs. I got another one that stays down the street from one another. So they are there for the children.
Yeah.
So that the children understand that this is a situation between mommy and daddy. This has nothing to do with you. But I take that back. Sometimes it does, because children can be the cause of a divorce.
If there's illness, you know, sometimes emotional illnesses or physical illnesses, it can be really taxing.
Or abuse.
Mm-hmm. Or abuse, right. And I guess I'm fortunate. I have not really worked with a lot of people in those situations. But it's just so important to approach, especially young children, with a sense of confidence and that it's going to be okay, and remind them that they are loved. And, you know, I remember listening to a therapist talk about a child having gone through a loss and them saying what a child needs the most of at this point in time are boundaries, because boundaries keep them safe.
Mm.
You know? And, you know, kids don't like boundaries, but when you say mom's job is to keep you safe, that goes a long way with a child. You know, they feel the love, and to just be honest, and, you know, dad may be doing this and that's what dad's doing, but this is what we do here. And, you know, making those things clear. And the thing about especially younger kids, they get it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they know when they're not safe, you know, at dad's house or mom's house, depending on what the situation is. And, you know, that's where getting them help is important as well.
So when you came up out of the fog, because it's cloudy, you know, what did you say to yourself? What kind of conversations were you having with yourself? And what did you do to regain your self-esteem?
Took a while, I must say. And the self-esteem part is kind of an insidious thing. I had three words that guided me through those first probably 2 years. I made my decisions based on how I wanted to feel, and I wanted calm, safety, and a little bit of joy. And that was it.
Mm.
And if I was in a situation that was missing one of those things, I would take myself out of it. I recommend, and I remember doing just little things to help me feel more courageous. And to kind of get my mojo back, you know, whether it was the first time I went to the movies by myself or the first time I had dinner by myself someplace, you know, stepping in to doing the things I wanted to do just on my own, that was super important. I was very protective of my time and who I shared my situation with.
Oh, I know, because you got that negative Nelly, honey, and I'm telling you, she can't wait for you to call so she can put the little dig in. Oh, you know, Sue, oh honey, I'm so sorry. Well, I saw him and her at the golf tournament, and you know, this and what are you doing? Are you dating? Are you
all of
that kind of stuff. You just shut that down. I would turn it right back around on her. Well, really. Well, you were doing a whole lot of investigating for me. You must have had a horrible time. You did nothing for yourself. You have to, you got to confront those people in a very strategic way.
Yeah.
Because
you're right.
It doesn't have to be combative and it doesn't have to be confrontational, but it needs to be clear. To let them know that if me and you are going to continue to be friends, then you need to get out of my business and become my friend.
Yep. You are so right. So that is, I put those kinds of situations into what I call social self-care.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
And the ability to say, no, I don't really feel like going to this thing tonight. You know, I just don't want to, blah, blah, blah. And if a friend can't accept that for what it is, then I have to reevaluate the relationship. I worked a lot. The other thing that brought me a tremendous amount of strength was just taking care of myself physically.
Like that Pilates table you got right there?
You got it. I mean, it's that and gyrotonics and taking walks. And I woke up one morning and I said, divorce is not going to define me.
That's
and of
right.
course, now I'm a divorce coach, but you know, how we define ourselves is unique. I mean,
what, did you do something else? Did you maybe cut your hair or?
I didn't. Those things.
Get a boob job.
Hell no, I didn't need one of those.
Good for you. But there are, you know, there are times where people are dealing with the imposter syndrome. They don't know who they are.
Right.
So they feel that I have been, you know, Susie Homemaker for the last 15 years, and now I've got to go out there and take the world by storm. I'm going to get, you know, butt injections and a boob job and cut my hair and, you know, do all of these things, put on a wig and turn into somebody that I'm not because I'm living a facade. I still haven't allowed myself to settle in. Let yourself settle in, brains, before you do all of that. Or I'm going to go get me this young suitor. I'll show him. He's got a young girl. I'll get a young guy, girl, and be done tricked you out of all your little money.
There you go. You know, it's so interesting. I'm not opposed to doing, you know, I mean, if you want a boob job or a facelift, it's like, I don't know if I would do it because I was divorced. I would do it because that's what I wanted to do. And that would be what I would, you know, ask someone to check in with themselves. It's like, would you have done this when you were married, you know? And if you wouldn't, and now it's important, at least be able to be clear about why you would do that.
Absolutely.
But, you know, there's a internal transition things and there's external transition things. And if you don't deal with what's happening to you internally, the rest is just moving furniture, you know? So you can go ahead and do those things and probably feel a little bit better, but how long is it going to last? And
right.
That's what really, you know, and it's overwhelming. So a lot of times we chunk things down to look at, like, what do you want to do about your health? What do you want to do about your physical appearance? What do you want to do about money? And you kind of very slowly create your vision of each one of those areas of your life and move forward to do it. And that's how you create acceptance. That's how you get rid of the fear associated with uncertainty. And slowly but surely, that's how you get to that new beginning. Because it's not overnight. It takes months to just lose that emotional, biological connection of having lived with someone for a long time. You know, I mean, you walk around your house and you kind of have this feeling that your spouse is still there.
Mm-hmm.
It takes a while for those things to go away, really.
And then if you're empathic or a people pleaser, it's even more difficult because now you feel a certain kind of obligation. Forget the negative talk from the friend, but you got the family. Oh, okay. Well, John's not here with us at Thanksgiving dinner. And oh my God, you know, I used to love the way he put the bulbs on the tree. And then you've got the mother that still loves the son-in-law, regardless. You've got the father that still loves the daughter-in-law. So it's a lot of negotiation with the blended family and then the stepchildren.
Yeah.
Having your proper paperwork, your living will and trust. Knowing what assets you have.
Yep.
Again, you at home all day. You can go through the file cabinet. You can go through the safe and find out exactly what's going on, because divorce can really bring some people up out the ground.
Yep.
But you never thought that they would do this to you. you know, or for you. So be aware and be conscious, but also be sensitive and be kind. And that sensitivity starts with self. Not you, you'll get to that point where you'll be able to be more delicate with that other individual. But be tender with yourself. Love on yourself. Exercise, you know, look in the mirror. Keep a journal. Look at where you were, where you are, and where you aspire to be. Go back and do some self-reflection. Go on a retreat. Go on a trip. Do some meditation. There's a lot of things that you can do to raise that level of self-awareness. Wouldn't you agree, Sue?
Oh, completely. You're so on the mark with that, April. That's one of the reasons there are so many divorce meetups and things like that and rebuilding programs for people in divorce. It's always more effective for most people to be in a group and have, you know, people who are experiencing similar systems. And if they're well facilitated groups, they're not bitch fests. They're about, you know, discussing your feelings and as a group, co-creating ways to help each other move forward during difficult times. And even practicing, you know, those difficult conversations with family members so that it's not like, you know, the holiday meal blow up where you can say, look, we're getting into the holidays and these are my feelings and this is what I would appreciate that you do or that you don't do at the dinner table in discussing so-and-so. You know, I mean, these are reasonable.
And if they can't, you know, if they can't meet you halfway and honor your space and they just keep want to poke in the bear, then maybe that's not the dinner that you want to attend that particular year. But you, again, have to set boundaries.
Yeah. And, you know, when you are saying about how you go through this, it is such an amazing growth process. And if you allow yourself to experience the emotions and grieve and all of those different kinds of things, you emerge so much more confident and strong. Mm-hmm. And it's amazing. So many of the women I know are divorced and were divorced later in life, and they are doing amazing things. They're running amazing businesses. They went back to their art. They're taking care of their kids, their grandkids as part of what they do. And they're quite happy.
They are. But again, that happiness high is like we were talking about in Colorado. You were saying, oh, you know, everybody, there's a lot of homeless here in Colorado. And I was like, really? You go, yeah, well, because of the marijuana, you know, people think that it was because of the marijuana. They were the first state to legalize and all of that. And I told her, marijuana just makes you happy, horny, and high. It don't make you homeless. So when you're dealing with that, you know, love on yourself and realize that this is a part of the process. To whom much is given, much is required. And what don't kill you only makes you stronger.
You're right. You know?
And there is so much more of life to live. You didn't come here as Siamese twins. Go your own way. Yeah. Find your own way. Be determined to, you know, forge ahead and find a new path. And you can do that with great people like Sue Horwitz. You know, she's turned her pain into now her passion to helping women. Do you work primarily with women?
I do. I work primarily with women.
Right.
I mean, well, I have coach men, but.
You know, and men, you can get some help too, because I don't want to ever leave people thinking that men are one way. Men are human beings and they're vulnerable too. And it's not always the man that leaves the wife. A lot of times it's the wife that leaves the husband, and things happen. And then he's there thinking that he's been working 20 years like a slave to do everything for this woman. And now all of a sudden, wham, bam, boom, she doesn't like my pot belly and my Birkenstocks anymore. That doesn't turn her on. So there's help for you too. And if Sue is not, you know, the perfect fit, I know that she knows a plethora of people.
I do.
Before we conclude, I just kind of want to touch on one thing, the reconnect. Okay, flirting is an art. Now, and I'm not saying that you're going to run out and get a suitor, but if you are, be careful of this online dating and listen to one of my shows, bless her heart, catfished out of $400,000 in 3 months because you're looking for love in all the wrong places. You're vulnerable. You're tender. But learn the art of flirting. It's a lot different now. People are doing it online. It's not where you would go and, you know, bat your eyes from across the room. But be open to love. Be open to receive that. And don't go in your new relationship talking about your old one.
Take time. You know, that is the best advice. Take time before you run off and file. Really take time. We feel, you know, because our lizard brain is going crazy, we feel we have to do something immediately, and we don't. In many cases, except, you know, if there's some sort of violence or abuse in the home. You know, and there are so many people out there that are qualified to help you with, you know, even how to get back into the dating world. It's,
the art of conversation. It doesn't need to necessarily be a date.
Yeah.
But to have a conversation with someone without always talking about John. Okay. Right. And me and John used to go to this restaurant. Oh, and I remember, you know, my hair blowing in the wind when we had our convertible. Well, John is not there anymore. So start having a conversation about Sue, April, Betty, who you are. What are the things that you like? What are some of the things that you've never explored before? Where are the places that you want to go? It's all about you at this point, brains. It's not about the other person. Sue, you are a superstar. You really are. And you look fabulous.
Thank you. It's been so nice to spend the morning with you.
Well, I love it too. Please tell my brains how to get in contact with you. I want them to reach out. I want them to talk to you, consult with you, because you are definitely a needed asset.
Thank you. So people can reach me on my website, which is Sue Horwitz Coaching, and it's 10. And they can also just email me at sue@suehorwitz.com. And, you know, if they have questions or they are looking for someone in their own regional area, they should feel free to reach out to me. A lot of times divorce can be very geographic. And if you want to know people in different parts of the country to help you, I'm part of a network of divorce coaches and people who are more than happy to help you find help where you need it.
Well, I call her a divorce concierge because she has a full suite of services that is going to be able to help you deliver and arrive to a safe destination. Thank you so much, Sue. I appreciate you and value you. Keep me posting us what's going on there in Colorado, and maybe you can give me some suggestions on, you know, things that I can talk to my guests about moving forward. You give them tips and tricks, because I want them to be happy, whether you're with or without a spouse, okay? Here on the edge. Thank you so much, precious. Bye, brains. Have a good day.